mRNA vaccines changed the course of the COVID-19 pandemic and saved countless millions of lives. And then they just dusted off their hands, said, "My work here is done," and rode off into the sunset, never to be heard from again. Kidding, obviously. The success of mRNA vaccines against COVID-19 marks a sea change in how we approach, like, healthcare, at least the diseases part. mRNA vaccines worked once, and that means they have the potential to keep working again and again and again and again. Here's why we think mRNA vaccines are here to stay, from your yearly flu shot to cancer and beyond. DNA may be the information that life is based on, but it requires proteins to execute that code. mRNA stands for messenger RNA, and it's a bit of genetic information that acts as a middleman between the two. Since your cells don't want to make every single protein every single time, they make mRNA as like a TLDR just for the proteins you need. And this is a neat little function to exploit for vaccines. We've covered the nitty-gritty of how mRNA vaccines work in earlier episodes, so if you're curious, you can check that out. But for now, here's the TLDR. In general, traditional vaccines deliver proteins from bad germs, called pathogens, into your body, or they deliver a killed or weakened version of the germ, etc. The idea is to introduce the real pathogen's proteins to get your immune system to recognize the bad guy. But mRNA vaccines don't give you any of the actual virus. All they do is deliver a little bit of mRNA that codes for a viral protein, and then your cell's natural protein-making machines can go to work. Then the cell can present the finished pathogen protein to the immune system, so the immune system knows who to beat up. And this is a huge advantage, because making mRNA is easier, faster, and more flexible than growing a pathogen in a lab, which is what's required for more traditional vaccine approaches. As long as we know the genetic sequence for the target protein, making the corresponding mRNA is basically the world's easiest cipher. Then we can package that mRNA into a vaccine for nearly any protein you want. Let me say that again. Any protein you want. This is incredibly useful for pandemic response when time is of the essence. During the COVID-19 pandemic, scientists were able to create a candidate for the vaccine within days of the virus's genetic information being published. Plus, mRNA vaccines are super adaptable. When you have to grow a vaccine from scratch, it's really hard to make small tweaks to it. But with mRNA, if your edits are simple enough, you can just rewrite the code and take the old code out, put the new code in, and shake it all about. As another plus for mRNA vaccines, you can include the genetic information for a bunch of different proteins into the same shot in order to get a broader immune response. With a traditional vaccine, different proteins might have different needs that make it hard for them to hang out together in one shot. But mRNA molecules are all pretty similar to one another and are happy to mingle. Even though it may have seemed like mRNA vaccines popped up overnight during the COVID-19 pandemic, the earliest work on mRNA vaccines had started decades before 2020. Researchers actually cracked a few important technical challenges just in time for these mRNA vaccines to be adapted for the pandemic. The main issue was that mRNA molecules are really unstable. In your cells, mRNA can get broken down within several hours, which doesn't guarantee enough time for your immune system to do its thing. Plus, because of the size and electrical charge of mRNA molecules, it was difficult to find a way to get the mRNA inside the cell in the first place. And amazingly, both of these issues were addressed by using a tiny fatty bubble called a lipid nanoparticle. Lipid nanoparticles are made up of fatty molecules that provide a nice safe little pocket for the mRNA to hang out in. And once it reaches your cell membrane can swallow up that bubble. Then, the cell's internal environment makes the bubble burst, and surprise, you've got mRNA. In summary, what happens is this. Scientists write the code for any protein they want your immune system to respond to. That code gets packaged neatly until your cells can open it up and get to work translating it. Then, the immune system sees the translated protein product and knows to keep an eye out for it later. This technology works great for COVID, but like I said earlier, the floodgates are opening, and it's poised to work great for a lot of other things.
This SciShow video is sponsored by Brilliant. Brilliant is an online learning platform with thousands of lessons in computer science, math, and science. You can even learn how to work with artificial intelligence using skills you gain from professionals at Microsoft and Google who helped make these brilliant lessons. And it's interactive. You get to train models on data and generate cover letters and other stuff that you used to have to write from scratch all by yourself. Plus, since you learn this stuff through hands-on problem solving, you're more likely to actually remember it. You can get started today at brilliant.org/SciShow or the link in the description down below. That link also gives you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, and you'll get your first 30 days for free.
Let's start with a vaccine that might simply save you from needing to get poked a bunch of times. Researchers are well on their way to developing a combined vaccine for COVID-19 and the flu. According to Moderna, one company behind this effort, this combination vaccine takes full advantage of the fact that you can mix together multiple mRNA molecules. They simply combine the mRNA from two separate COVID and flu mRNA vaccines into one shot. Both individual vaccines, as well as the combined vaccine, have promising phase 3 clinical trial results. If all goes according to plan, getting protection from two diseases in one shot shot would be a great way to double the power of your yearly flu shot. But COVID and the flu aren't the only things that researchers are working on. One of the first mRNA vaccines was actually tested in humans several years before the pandemic. As early as 2013, clinical trials had started for an mRNA vaccine for rabies. Rabies is a deadly virus that infects your nervous system, and humans usually get it from being bitten or scratched by an infected animal. But you probably aren't getting the shot unless it's already a life or death situation, because the traditional rabies vaccine options are just way too expensive. A single dose of the rabies vaccine can cost $400 in the US, and you have to fulfill the required 2 to 4 doses for a full vaccination. That is a huge healthcare cost, even if you have insurance. Even in the UK with government health insurance, the full series can run you more than £200. So unless you're in some kind of like high-risk profession, like a veterinarian, you're not gonna have to see this thing unless you've already been exposed to rabies. That might be different from what you typically think of when it comes to vaccines, but fortunately it works for rabies, as long as you get the shot before any symptoms start. But having a cheaper, more effective mRNA vaccine could allow preventative rabies vaccines to be given out more widely, and prevent up to 70,000 annual deaths from rabies worldwide. Two studies on rabies mRNA vaccines have shown initial promise in mice and in rhesus macaques. In both studies, the researchers were able to demonstrate that 2 shots of these mRNA vaccines were much more effective at preventing rabies than 2 shots of a traditional vaccine. In rhesus macaques, just 1 dose of the mRNA vaccine was enough to get an immune system response comparable to the level and duration of 2 doses of the traditional vaccine. As another example of a vaccine that's been given after the disease has already been diagnosed, let's talk about cancer. One easy example is you might have gotten the HPV vaccine, which protects you against infection from human papillomavirus. While the vaccine does prevent nearly all cases of several types of cancer caused by HPV, it's not a vaccine against the cancer itself. In order to make a cancer vaccine that actually targets the cancer, we need a target protein that marks the cancer for destruction, but not your healthy cells. The proteins that we've found uniquely on tumor cells are called tumor-specific antigens, or TSAs. Not the TSA, but if science could get a vaccine against airport security, that would be great. TSAs are highly variable, and they can be specific to the type of tumor, or even specific to the individual patient. And because they can be so specific, you need a sample of the tumor before you can figure out what someone's TSAs look like. That's why many cancer vaccines are therapeutic vaccines, meaning a vaccine that treats an existing disease rather than preventing it. This still counts as a vaccine because they make your immune system make antibodies to fight the disease, which could also ideally be used to fight any like reappearances. And while we know that TSAs exist, we don't have the vaccines for them yet. So how could mRNA technology change that? Firstly, we could combine the mRNA for multiple tumor proteins into one vaccine. This could get a stronger response from your immune system than a traditional vaccine. And secondly, remember how we said that making small variations to one mRNA vaccine can be done pretty easily? We can use this to tailor mRNA vaccines to a patient's specific tumor. This feature was put to the test in a 2023 study that developed personalized mRNA vaccines for pancreatic cancer. Pancreatic cancer is a notoriously difficult cancer to treat due to its location in the body and general lack of obvious early signs, so developing a good therapy is in high demand. In this clinical trial, the doctors surgically removed patients' pancreatic cancer and then sent the tumor off to get DNA sequenced. Then, scientists looked for TSAs in patients' genetic sequence and made the associated mRNA to put in a custom-tailored vaccine. These personalized vaccines were able to get a strong immune response in half the study participants, and within that 50% of participants who got that strong immune response, all of them remained cancer-free after 1.5 years. It's unclear why the other half of participants didn't respond as well to the vaccine, so research is figuring out how to give this benefit to more people, or at least figure out which patients are most likely to benefit from these vaccines. This clinical trial was a phase 1 trial, and vaccines were only made and administered to 16 people. Phase 1 trials are all about working out the kinks with a new drug, so maybe they'll be able to figure out how to make it work for more people. But these promising initial results give scientists the confidence to move forward with larger trials. In addition to pancreatic cancer, mRNA vaccines are also being explored for treating melanoma, brain cancer, and lung cancer. So there's a lot of reason to be excited. This is one of the most powerful new tools in healthcare we've seen, maybe ever. But that's not to say that there aren't a few things in the way. One problem is intellectual property rights. A lot of the breakthroughs in mRNA vaccine technology have been developed by private companies. And since private companies want to protect their intellectual property, this can slow down the process of sharing knowledge with other researchers when various intellectual property laws clash with each other. But credit where it's due, there are some scientific benefits to having private as well as publicly funded research. Private companies tend to be much more flexible in targeting new research directions and are willing to invest in riskier research endeavors. During the COVID-19 pandemic, private companies were the ones to swiftly develop the critically needed vaccines, including Moderna and the collaboration between Pfizer and BioNTech. Also, and this is a very human thing, it's somewhat less exciting to be tackling diseases that aren't new and shiny. In 2022, 80% of the leading vaccine developers were primarily focused on COVID-19 mRNA vaccines, which makes sense given, you know, the pandemic. But other diseases still need vaccines too. However, with less money being poured into long-standing diseases, it's hard for institutions, private or public, to prioritize them. mRNA vaccines have absolutely revolutionized the global pandemic response, and we're inclined to believe that we're not done with them yet. But developing these great vaccines can't stop a pandemic if the knowledge of them isn't shared freely. And once the vaccines get there, we need to ensure that people can get to healthcare facilities and trained professionals in order to receive those vaccines. We also need to consider issues of access if we truly want to maximize vaccines' potential. But that potential, well, it's massive. mRNA vaccines really saved us during the COVID-19 pandemic, and scientists are ready to wield them again against a whole bunch of diseases. They're fast, they're flexible, and they finally work. I'm not saying that all diseases are over forever, but I am saying that this new tool is more than just a buzzword. Hopefully, it brings hope to a lot of people.